Have you ever stopped on the street to listen to a busker cover a famous song on guitar and thought to yourself, that doesn't sound right? It seems bland, or the edges have been rounded off in some way. Whatever it is, the spirit of the original just isn't being captured. I was on the London Underground recently at around 8 a.m, surrounded by something like 80 other bleary-eyed commuters, when a guy twice my age rocked into the carriage, acoustic guitar in hand, and proceeded to belt out a version of Pink Floyd's Comfortably Numb. Odd choice, but let's not get into that. As he continued playing, I became really interested because his version was such a rough approximation that you'd almost believe he'd never heard the original. The main thing that ruined what he was doing was his incessant use of what a friend of mine calls zombie chords, which are the first chords you learn when you begin playing guitar. Take the chord C, for example. This can be played 50 different ways, but for reasons I'm going to go into, whenever it's called for, it's nearly always played the same way. There are a dozen or so of these elementary chords, commonly called open chords, that just keep popping up. This is why they're referred to as zombie chords, so overused they sound dead. And they're everywhere, infecting guitar covers with a generic sameness and sucking the life out of performances. This is understandable for beginners, less so everyone else. Need an example? Okay, well, first listen to this. And now listen to this and ask yourself, how distinguishable is it really from the first example? So you probably recognize this style of playing already, either from parties or from watching buskers on the street. Well, there's a reason for it. It's a peculiar problem with the way guitar is often taught to beginners, which some of them then continue to do for the rest of their lives, and which publications and online resources have a tendency to encourage. When you first pick up a guitar, you'll most likely start by learning some of the following chords: E, E minor, C, G, D, A minor, and if you're feeling adventurous, F, and possibly that miserable bone-crunching B. These are some of the nicest sounding and most resonant chords the instrument can produce, and their heyday seems to have been in the 60s and 70s, a time when their no-frills, no-nonsense sound appealed to rock and folk musicians.
The answer, my friend, is a-blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind.
Of course, they can still be used to great effect today. But what are these chords actually? Well, just to spend 30 seconds on them for the benefit of non-musicians, these chords are based on what's called a triad, named so because they consist of three notes. Triads are the core of standard Western harmony. For example, C major is made up of the notes C, E, and G, which you can see being played here on a piano. For guitar, because there are six strings, you'll often see some notes appearing more than once. Here's the guitar version of C, consisting again of C, E, and G, and then C and E repeated once more. Each of these chords are really grounded sounding, and because of that, they can sound a bit clunky if used in combination all the time. For this reason, writers often drop what's called the third from their chords. For example, in C major, the third would be the note E. So let's delete those E's, and we're left with this chord, which now consists of just the root note C, which is at the top and at the bottom, and the fifth note G, sandwiched in the middle. Now let's just replace that diagram, and this is called a power chord. It is a raw sound that works particularly well on electric guitar. So that's the first thing out of the way. All these chords have a third. The second thing to note about them is that they're all in what's called root position, meaning that the root note, which is the note the chord is named after, in this case C, is the lowest. Root position chords sound really grounded and are easy to recognize. However, they too can get a little boring if used all the time, so people often reorder them. This is what's called a first inversion, where the E is the lowest note. And here's a second inversion, where the G is the lowest note. Each of these versions has a different quality due to the relationship between the upper two notes and the bass note. So now that I've pointed these two things out, what use do they have? Well, let's take a look. Here's a standard chord progression where all the chords are triads and all of them are in root position. Now here's the same progression where various inversions are being used and where some of the chords are dropping the third. Hear the difference? By making these adjustments, the second version has a clear melodic direction. One way to highlight this is by isolating the top notes of each version. Here's the first. And here's the second. Now, just to be clear, I'm not saying that the second arrangement is better than the first, or that the standard chords are not good. I'm simply pointing out the wide possibilities for variation in harmonic language. The more of that language you have at your disposal, the better you'll be at finding something that works perfectly for you. When standard chords are simply defaulted to uncritically, that's when they become dead, ossified zombie chords. So why do these chords keep creeping into places where they don't belong? Well, I think the variable quality of how guitar is taught plays a big part. Technology, as always, is a mixed blessing. Guitar notation websites, however useful, are filled with garbage. When I want to learn how to play something, I often have to sort through 5 or 6 different versions before finding something half decent. There are also a million guitar tuition apps out there that talk big, claiming to teach absolute novices to play a Beatles song in a few minutes. This is such a bad way to learn. Even the most advanced musicians out there try playing difficult music slowly before attempting a regular tempo. Not to mention, there are thousands of songs that actually use standard chords. Why not just teach one of those rather than bastardizing ones that don't? YouTube is definitely shaking things up for the better. It's a little harder to get away with awful suggestions when you have to actually play them in person. That said, there are quite a few lazy videos out there that claim to give you access to everything by learning only a handful of chords.
And I'm going to be showing you how to play 10 Beatles songs with only 4 chords.
And I'm going to play 28 songs using the exact same 4 chords, 37 songs using the same 4 chords.
Okay, enough of that. Let's talk about Paperback Writer by the Beatles, a song that sounds much better when played like this. And now compare that to these.
Here we go. I wanna be a paperback seater.
Paperback seater. This happens quite a lot, people mixing up the names of the chords with the lyrics.
G, let it see.
You know you can just put the chords on the screen, right? Like this. So that aside, let's take a moment to reflect on what should be the gold standard, the official Beatles songbook for guitar. This book is described for players as easy, yet the version of Blackbird you'll find here is actually way harder to play than the original. Let's have a listen to my attempt to play a portion of it. Rather than strumming, which incidentally sounds ridiculous, I've let each chord ring out so that you can hear exactly how they're working. The sharp-eared among you will notice a really nasty dud note in my vocals, which we'll investigate afterwards.
Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these broken wings and learn to fly. All your life. You were only waiting for this moment to arrive.
Okay, so to begin, when I sing the lyrics, "You were only waiting," it sounds like I was way off. I wasn't. I even used some software to check the pitch to make sure. The problem is the really baffling choice of chord, a diminished 7th chord on an A sharp at the moment that I'm meant to be singing a B. That's right, A sharp against B in the same register. Let me just show you what that combination sounds like. Christ, sounds like Blackbird's been strangled in the dead of night. Why this chord was chosen is beyond me, especially when a more appropriate one was specified only a few bars earlier. Here's that exact same vocal line where I've replaced my guitar with a MIDI guitar playing a more appropriate chord.
You are only waiting for this moment to arrive.
But even if you make that improvement, this version is unplayable, and I feel really sorry for the hundreds and thousands of suckers who've banged their heads against their tables trying to learn it. Literally every chord is poorly chosen. An excellent example of using the illusion of simplicity to ruin the spirit of the original. So, the predictable criticism, which I've had thrown at me before, will be something like this. Who are you to say what chords are right and wrong? This is contrary to the spirit of interpretation. And my answer is this. You're not interpreting anything if you keep returning to prescribed patterns. The purpose of this channel is to get people to think about how music works, in this case by questioning ossified practices as a way of encouraging people to regard their instrument with curiosity. If you've chosen your chord from a range of other possibilities, then great. If the chord you've chosen is the only one you know, or because a website told you to use it, then the term freedom of interpretation is a little hard to swallow. So anyway, next time you hear a busker mangling one of your favourite tunes, hold on to your cash and save it for someone else who displays a bit more finesse. Let the market do its work. Ah no, I'm only kidding. The market's already done its work. That's why there's such a thing as buskers. Ah, okay, that was a joke too. I don't believe any part of what I just said.
If you like my diatribe, subscribe!